Welcome back, everybody. Welcome back to the channel. So today we're going to be talking about how to build an opcode generation system. Now, this video is going to be kind of long, so I'm going to put timestamps in the description below if you guys want to kind of just jump around. But I want to get this all done in one video because I don't want to have a part two and a part three for this because I don't really think it's necessary. So let's get right into it. So today we're going to be talking about, like I said, my opcode generation system. Now, when you're building a programming language, you are going to want to predetermine your opcodes. Now, I've had the privilege of being able to develop this language over the course of 6 years, so I've had plenty of time to think about my operands and why I need them. Honestly, for you probably will not have as many operands as I do in the beginning. I think when I initially started and wrote my very first virtual machine, I probably had maximum 10 to 15 opcodes. And over the years, it's just grown into something more as I've built a more complicated programming language. So as you can see down here, I created a data structure called opcode, and it has just a list of opcodes. So we can go down the list, but I start with my first illegal instruction. And again, we're gonna have to go through all of these opcodes just in this YouTube video because I don't want to have a part two and a part three, like I said. So I also have what's called an opcode builder. Now, this is that part of the video when we kind of get into that. That's not going to be something that's necessary for your programming language. If you don't want to do it, it's totally fine. You can opt out of doing that and just skip over that part of the video. However, before you do that, I highly recommend that you don't do that and you actually do build this opcode builder system because it's going to make generating code for your programming language a crap ton easier. Not to mention, it's also going to make actually generating those instructions a lot less error prone because as you're building your compiler, you're going to have tons of opcodes that you're going to be generating randomly all over the place. And as you're generating them, even though I've built this entire programming language from scratch, I still forget time to time what certain opcodes do and why I even need them in the first place. So I end up having to go back in my source code to check to see why do I need this again, or even worse, I might need to do something in the compiler as I'm building it, and I don't even know what opcode to use. So I end up having to go through and search to see which one I need. But this is a handy way for you to be able to limit the amount of errors in your compiler. Ever since I built this, I've had no issues with opcode generation, so I'll just leave it at that. But before we get into any of this, so before we get into talking about each opcode and stuff, first, we need to understand what is an instruction. So we're going to start up here with our instruction code. And as you can see, I have several different types of instructions, and they're in a 32-bit layout. Now, this is kind of cryptic. I mean, we can kind of see this. We'll go back to it in a little bit, but I've actually made a few pictures for you guys to kind of visualize how we're going to be looking at our instructions. So if I go here, now, these pictures are not going to be perfect. Like, the amount of zeros in this array is not exactly 32 bits. It's just there for illustration. So just keep that in mind. The picture's not going to be perfect. But considering that our programming language is that we want to run it on both a 32-bit and a 64-bit operating system, that means that every single opcode in our programming language has to be by default 32-bit instructions. Meaning that even if you run your code or compile it for a 64-bit machine, it's still going to have a maximum width of 32 bits per instruction because you still need to support the 32-bit operating system. A very perfect example of doing this is actually something that I'm experiencing right now in real time. So if some of you don't know, I'm actually working on a drone project for using my programming language. And it's done 100% in my language. It's custom. I also do a little bit of C++ code in here too, but it's pretty complicated. I definitely recommend you guys check it out. It's a pretty interesting project. But what's important here is that I have all this source code, right? So I'm just going to go to a file here. So I'm going to go to my network code. This is how I talk between multiple devices using some software that I wrote. So if I go to, I don't know, remote, right? And I have this code in here. Well, I have tons of code in this project. This project is starting to grow into something a lot bigger because I'm adding more code to it. Because my programming language is both supporting 32 and 64-bit, that means that I can compile this code on both operating systems. And if I compile it on a 64-bit, it can then also take that source code of that file and also run it on a 32-bit. Well, with that, what I end up actually doing is the cool thing about Sharp is that it does not know or it does not have to care about what it's doing with C++. So I have some stuff in here that I'm not going to go into, that I'm doing something very specific to the Raspberry Pi itself in C++. But in order to speed up the development time of this project, I actually compile all the source code on my computer, and then I take that source code and I port that code to the actual Raspberry Pi because it's faster, because I have an i7 processor, so I can literally just take that code and push it to the Raspberry Pi, and I don't have to wait 5 hours for all of the source code to compile and be ready. So that's one perfect example of doing that. But if we look here, every programming language is going to be different in terms of how it processes operands. This is not based on any system, so I know a lot of things I've said in the past have been based on other systems. However, the way I process operands is just made up. It's just whatever. So depending on you guys' system will depend on how these opcodes will be laid out, but let's just go into how mine are. So for 32-bit, I have eight. I probably should have put that here, but I have 8 bits of the 32-bit instruction or the 32-bit number allocated to just the opcode alone. That means that we have a maximum opcode limit of 255. So we cannot have no more than 255 opcodes, otherwise it will not fit in the instruction. And then the remainder bits I have are the maximum amount of bits that can potentially be allocated for an operand or any number of operands. And that equates to a total of 24 bits. So that's how many bits that are left in the actual 32-bit instruction. Let's go over to C. So I have a couple of different classes for my programming language, and let's go through each of them. So, whoops, that's a little too zoomed in. Wait, why is it not scrolling? Oh, I have to drag it. Okay. So for my instruction classes, I have a couple different ones. So let's start at the top and just kind of go down. So first, I have what's called a class E instruction. Now, the names of these do not matter. They're just arbitrary names. I just came up with various different names for the classes to classify the type of instruction that each one is. So class E instructions are very basic instructions. Literally, all they retain is just an opcode. So it'll be, let's say 54 number opcode, and the rest of the data in there is just blank data. It doesn't hold any value. It's pointless. So these are going to be very simple opcodes like no op, like pushing something onto the stack or popping something off the stack. It just depends on what the opcode is doing that makes it not require any operands. Now let's actually look at a couple of instructions that actually require operands. So I have two instructions here, class D and class C. Now the way that I do operands in my programming language is I have what's called a plus and minus bit, and then I have the actual operand here. This allows me to have a maximum value or take up the maximum amount of space for each operand, right? So for specifically the class D, I have my first 8 bits again allocated to each opcode. And all of these classes, by the way, have a standard of 8 bits for the entire opcode. So that's always going to be the same, but the amount of bits allocated to each operand, as you can see, are different. So as you can see, so the plus and minus is going to basically determine whether or not this value here or this full operand is plus or minus. So I think class D instructions, what is it? Plus or minus, it is 8 million whatever. So 8 point, is that 8.3 million? Yeah, so 8,300,000 is the maximum positive and negative value of that instruction. So if I go back, so that is a total of 24 bits. Now if you look at class C, I have two plus or minus bit operands or bit values here. And I have two operands for C class instructions. For class C instructions, I have the first operand being 4 bits wide and the second operand being 18 bits wide. Why 4 and 18? Well, again, it just depends on your system and how you're going to build it. As we start getting into the nitty-gritty of our virtual machine, we're going to have what's called registers. Registers are just like any register that is on an actual CPU. And we're going to use those registers as a means of transferring and manipulating data throughout our programming language. But yeah, so that is class C. And then finally, we have B class instructions. B class instructions are 3 bits here. So we have 3 plus or minus bits. And then we have 3 consecutive operands that are each 7 bits wide. Because if we multiply that times 3, that's 21, 22, 23, and 24. And if we scroll all the way to the top, we have a maximum of 24 bits. So it works out perfectly. So each of these values, I think, are like 127, if I'm not mistaken. Where is it at? Yeah, so 127 for those. For the class C, the max of the first argument or the 4-bit argument is 15, and the maximum value of the second argument is 260 something thousand. So this argument here, or the second one, so if we go back to this one, so these 4 bits would most likely be used for a register value. That's what I would use this for, because registers, I have, I think, a maximum of 10. I don't remember. We'll get into registers later, but I'm pretty sure I have a max of 10. So 4 bits encompasses 15 values. I can't do 3 bits because that would be too small. So I have to specifically use 4 bits to cover the entire amount of registers we have. So there's that, and then maybe like these next 18 bits would possibly be used for like a frame address or a stack address or just whatever, right? But obviously the lesser bits would be used for registers. And I actually think the class B instruction is just all registers. So the class B instruction is used mainly for like math. So if you say like add, you want to add, register A plus register B and put that value in register C. So that's kind of how this works. So let's go back. So now let's actually get into how we actually process the information. So I'm going to have what's called an opcode mask. That is 0xFF. So if I get my calculator out so we can actually see what some of these hex values are, 0xFF is actually 255. So that's the opcode mask. Now, hopefully, you guys read up a little bit on bit shifting. If some of you are curious about what bit shifting is or how it works, I will be putting links to that in the description below, with some simple tutorials kind of explaining what it is in C++. But we're gonna have that. We're also gonna have a positive, a negative value, an error state value. That's used for functions. You don't really need to care about that right now. Same with no error. I believe that's for functions as well. So you can ignore those two values. And then we have our maxes. So that's where this DA, CA, BA stands for. So the DA is D class argument max. So since we have one arg, it's just going to be D class argument max of 0x, whatever this is. So as you can see, that value pertains to this 8.3 million value up here. And for CA1 max or C argument 1 max, that is 0xF. And the U, by the way, stands for unsigned. That's what that U is for, if any of you are wondering. But the CA1 max is for 15. The CA or C argument 2 max is for the 262,000. And then finally, we have B class argument max of 7F, which is just 127. So I have several different ways of actually creating the arguments. So for E class arguments, it's very simple. So I have what's called I, and I represents the instruction. So I'm saying the instruction is equal to whatever the opcode that we pass in for the class E instruction. And if we have a D class instruction, I say, here's the instruction that we want to assign. I need to pass in the opcode, the first argument, and N, which represents whether or not it's a negative value. So what I do is I basically say the instruction is equal to op, and then I use an OR to basically add the additional values to the instruction. So I OR op with whether or not it's negative, and I left shift 8 bits to basically put this value here, positive or negative, and I AND it with positive. So positive is 1, negative is 0. So if N is positive, then we put a 1 here, otherwise it's 0. Then we add whatever A1 is, which is left shifted to the right of 9 to actually set the rest of the values for the D instruction. And then, of course, I do it for the other ones. If any of you guys are curious, you can just pretty much copy these down if you want to add various different classes or use the classes that I have. It covers a pretty wide range of instructions, so if you don't want to use all of these, you don't have to copy them all down. But yeah, so after we basically have a way to set up our instructions, now we need a way to get the values of our instructions. So as we're executing each of these instruction values, our CPU is going to go through what's called a fetch, decode, execute cycle. And that's what our virtual machine is going to go through. So basically, every time when we run into another instruction, we're going to, and you can kind of see it down here. So I have this dispatch code, and it's currently commented out. That is garbage. But I have this dispatch code where I basically jump to the opcode. So I fetch the opcode by calling get op, and I basically take the instruction of program counter, or the actual value, dereferencing the pointer of program counter. Program counter represents an integer pointer that's pointing to the actual address of each instruction. And I dereference that, and I fetch the instruction with this getOp. I jump to that instruction on the opcode table. It's just a list of addresses based on where each instruction is defined in the function. And then I decode that instruction by saying get DA if it's a D class, or get CA, CB if it's a C class, or so on and so forth. And then I execute that instruction, of course, by doing the actual thing that the instruction needs to do. Now, before we continue, there is something very important that I want you guys to think about as we're doing this. There's a phenomenon that's called instruction latency. And what that means is each instruction is going to take a different amount of time to execute as you're actually running your code in your virtual machine. So as you're building each instruction, you want to make sure you have that latency, air quotes, as low as possible. Basically meaning you don't want each instruction to do too much work. This is why I have, what is 0x76? I have no idea. I'm just going to type this in. So clear 76. I have a total of 118 instructions. That may seem like a lot, but considering how complicated my programming language is and the fact that I want my instruction latency to be as low as possible, I ended up creating a ton of instructions to achieve that low latency. So just keep that in mind. So let's go back up to the top. So we have all these various getter values, and I basically convert it to an int32 by basically taking the instruction, right-shifting it 8 bits, ignoring the actual instruction value, and this is for the DA instruction. So I basically just skip over all these, and I just read the bits after the opcode. And then I do that for other stuff as well. So depending on what I'm trying to get, if it is a CA or a CB, that means the first argument or the second argument. Or BA, BB, or BC, that means the first argument, second argument, and third argument, then I do the appropriate bit shift to actually get the value. So if we scroll down, so what do we have? So we don't need any of that. We will create this opcode table later, so you don't really have to worry about this dispatch thing yet. We'll get to that at a later point in our virtual machine, so I'm going to skip over all this code. Now, here we are at the point to where we're actually going to start creating our opcode generation system. So we're going to basically want to create two types. So we want to create a type of opcode instruction. In our programming language, we're going to have an opcode instruction represent an unsigned int. Or in other words, that represents a uint32 underscore t. So that would be the same value, an unsigned int, or a uint32 numeric value. And then for opcode argument, we want to have a max value of int. So that's going to be a maximum value of int32 underscore t. Meaning that each argument can have no more than, what is an int max? I don't even know. What is it, like 2 billion something? But you guys know what that number is. So that's what that represents. We also want to have an instruction buffer size. So each instruction, and I actually forgot to mention this, so even though we have these instruction classes here, we also have a third class, or what is it? No, that's, I can't count. What is this? 1, 2, 3, 4. So we actually have a fifth class that's not listed here. It doesn't really have an official name, but I guess what I can call it is a carryover instruction, meaning that it's an instruction that is so large that it actually has to carry over data from that instruction to another instruction because it just simply cannot fit all of the information inside of itself. So we'll see that in a little bit, but we're going to use an instruction buffer of size of 2 to be able to carry over that secondary data to that second instruction. So once you do that, you want to create a data structure of opcode, and then you want to create all of these different instructions. Now, I'm not going to go through, because if I go through this list, I would have to explain each one, and I still do, but I'm going to explain it down below. So basically all I do is I create a static constant uint8. And again, it has to be a 8-bit wide instruction because that is the maximum value. And of course I have this at the top, an illegal instruction of 0xFF or 255. So specifically for me, I have a maximum of 254 instructions. This instruction here is intended to break the language. The purpose of this is to specifically crash the virtual machine on purpose. Because if I scroll up to the top, this is actually has the value of 255, but I only have a maximum value of currently 100 and what is it, 118? I don't remember. Yeah, 118 instructions. So I can actually generate this instruction if I did something wrong in my compiler, and it would effectively crash the virtual machine. And then I can take that crash and I can look to see in the ODF file and then do a search for ILL. Now, obviously, I do have a search value here, but I don't have an illegal instruction that is actually in the source code because my compiler actually generates the code correctly. But it would be an easy way to just do a quick search in your file to like try to find the error. So keep that in mind. You definitely want to have this. And then after that, I basically just have a bunch of static UNET instructions. And I put them in all caps and assign it a value consecutively. Now, here's one thing that I want to share with you guys. As you build your programming language, you're going to experience something that's a huge pain in the ass. And that is, you're going to be swapping out instructions. Because as my programming language evolved, I actually removed and added several instructions. But because I have this numbering system where, this no-op is instruction value of 0, int is instruction value of 1, and so on and so forth, if I, let's say, remove put, right, I now have a problem. If I want to then go ahead and add another instruction in here, that's fine. I can add an instruction, let's say, right after throw, but it throws off the list. As you can see, I go from 0x27 to 0x29. So I now have to renumber all of these below, but that's a huge pain in the butt to actually physically have to do that. So I actually made some source code that does this for me. So if I scroll all the way to the bottom, because I'm lazy, what I did was I have a quick way to generate new address values for instructions. So if you guys are curious, you can go to, where is it at? It is in my lib, and then it is in the runtime, and then opcode.h. And you can just do a quick search at the bottom of the file for a quick way to generate new address values for the instruction. So I'm actually going to copy this code and paste it in an online IDE so you can actually see what it generates, and then we'll come back. All right, so it's actually written in Java, so it's actually Java code. But as you can see right here, I just basically paste it in the code and I say print hex and I just call print hex and it literally just prints out a value from 0 to like 500. And you can see here is 0x1 or 0123 blah blah blah, and then ABCDEF, and then it just keeps going. So it generates a bunch of hex code or hex values for you. So it's not perfect. There is some bugs with it when you get into the really high numbers. But for the most part, in our purposes, it works just fine. So definitely recommend doing that. So if you remove any specific number, you can just copy from that value and paste in the consecutive values below it. So now, once you do all that, once you kind of have a basic idea of what are some of the instructions you'd like to have, you can make some up. Then you're going to want to create what's called an enum of instruction underscore class. I have three in here, or I have a couple. So I have E class, D class, C class, and B class. And as you notice, the closer it gets to A, the more instructions that are required. That's just kind of a weird thing that I did with my classes. That's just kind of a weird naming convention I have with my classes. But now we're at the builder. So the builder is where I actually build the actual code. So I either return a opcode instruction or a pointer to an opcode instruction array. And what that's going to do is that's going to be a reference to an array that has a max instruction buffer size of 2. So that are those overflow instructions that I was talking about before. So let's just go down the list of every single instruction that we're going to need to create from top to bottom, and I'll explain quickly what each of them do. So you want to create a temp instruction of opcode instruction and an opcode instruction array of an instruction buffer of the max size, and that's just going to be a private field here, as you can see, and we'll use that as a way to return our instructions. So we'll get into what that is in a sec. So let's actually go down the list. So first we have no-op. That is going to be an E-class instruction. Pretty self-explanatory. No-op is short for no operation or nothing. Basically, it just does nothing. I actually do use this in the compiler. It is a great way of aligning instructions, and we'll get into what instruction alignment means later on. But yeah, so I do use that. We also have int. This is for interrupts. And this is going to represent a D-class instruction where it only has one argument, the actual opcode, and then the interrupt flag. And now here's the thing that I do with some of these instructions. Some of these instructions, I default the values to positive because we always know an interrupt flag is going to be positive. Now, before we continue going down the list, here's one of the massive benefits of using this builder class for actually generating opcodes. And by the way, all these are static functions. So you can just say builder colon colon, and then you just call whatever function you need to call. But one of the major benefits is that it is a function. So if you pass the wrong data, you'll actually get a compile time error, not a runtime error, where you figure out way down the line and it's a huge pain in the ass. So as you can see, I need to pass it an interrupt flag, and an interrupt flag represents all of the various system interrupts that I can do on my virtual machine that do very low-level things like creating threads and other crap that we'll get into later. But yeah, so if I pass like 7 here, it's not going to work. So that's one of the benefits. We have illegal instruction, which is an E-class instruction. We have move I. Move I is used for basically moving a value into a register. This is our first overflow instruction that we're going to be talking about, where it's basically starting out as a D-class instruction. So even though it is an overflow instruction, it still represents a certain class in the beginning. So we have move I, and then we pass it the register value as positive. And then the secondary value, or the overflow value of that instruction, is just the physical opcode argument, or a maximum integer value of whatever it is. So if we pass, 2 billion whatever, that is the maximum value that we can pass here. So this is a perfect example of like languages like Java, you can't have an int max more than that 2 billion number. This is one of those reasons why. And of course, I return the instruction buffer. I also have a clear buffer function here, which just clears up the buffer of the actual instruction buffer. So I just say whatever the bufflin is. Currently, I just pass in the instruction buffer size, which is 2. And I just set the values to -1. And yeah. So we also have return, which basically just means return a function. Now, I pass in an error state, and what that basically means is the way my exception system works is I basically try to throw an exception in the function itself, and then if that exception doesn't get caught, I return out of that function, and I can either return with an error state or without an error state. So that's kind of how that works. After that, I have halt, HLT, which is an E-class instruction, which just shuts down the current thread. It does not kill the entire virtual machine. It just shuts down the current thread that is executing source code. After that, I have new var array. This creates a new numeric array of numbers. And this is a D-class instruction. I pass it the register value of whatever it is. And then, of course, register values are always going to be positive. So again, I default the values to positive. Now, you want to create a registers enum. So I have an ADX register. And each of these registers, by the way, have a standard of what I use them for. So ADX is mainly for addresses, CX is mainly for counting, CMT is mainly for like math, EBX is the data register. That is a very important register. I use that for everything. ECX is a secondary data register. ECF, EDF, and EHF are general purpose registers that can just be used for anything. We have the BMR register. Oh, this one's actually used for math. So CMT is used for computing. I don't remember what that means, but basically both CMT and BMR are both used for like math computation. And then I have EGX, which is a temporary data storage register. So these three registers mostly are expected to be used by the user. So like if I wanted to write some code and I didn't want to interfere with my compiler, I can modify and manipulate these three registers if I didn't want to screw anything up. And that would basically guarantee that I would never break anything in the compiler because all three of these registers will never be used by the compiler for code generation. All of the other ones, though, are in fact used by the compiler. So if I go back out, so now let me see. So after that, we have cast. Cast is basically going to be allowing us to cast numeric values. I know it's kind of weird, we'll get into it later. But you just basically want to pass in an out register. Move 8 is a way for us to cast a value or a number to an int 8 or an 8-bit integer. Now, here's where I get into some of the fancy technology that I ended up adding into my opcode generation system. I have what's called an illegal parameter function, and this is actually used for more complicated opcodes that may need this. And basically what it does is I pass in the parameter, the instruction class, and then the argument number. And based on that information, I basically check to see if I've gone over the limit of that specific argument and that specific class. And this guarantees that if that happens and I return a true, basically immediately after that, I end up generating an illegal instruction, therefore forcing me to generate correct code by my compiler. So in the early days, as I was building my compiler, I actually did use this source code a lot, and it helped me find out various points in my code where I was passing data that was too large for a specific instruction. So this is very useful. So once you have that, you want to have a various different set of move instructions. So we have move 16, 32, 64, U8, U16. Basically, these are allowing us to cast values to a native integer. So considering that everything's a double in our programming language, this allows us to basically convert those double values to their integer counterparts. And of course, these are all C class instructions, so I basically require a register. So which register we're going to write the data to, and the register to cast, or which register we'd like to read the data from. And both of these are assumed to be positive values. After that, I have rstore. This allows us to store a register on the stack. This is a D class instruction with a positive default value. I have a bunch of math functions here. So I have add, sub, multiply, blah, blah, blah. And this is a B class instruction. So this uses this one right here where we have the three consecutive arguments. And this one basically allows us to do math on three different registers and all in one instruction. One of the really cool things that I like about this is that these used to be considered overflow instructions because it was just too much information. I would basically contain the first two registers, like which ones did you want to, let's say, add, and then the overflow instruction would be the out register. But that's a massive waste of space because you're only using maybe a couple of bytes in that secondary operand. So I ended up just smashing them all into one so that way you can save space in memory. After that, I have a series of IADD. So these are integer adds. Basically, what this is for these values, this only allows me to add values inside of registers, meaning that if I wanted to add values in the left and right register and put them in the out register, the value already has to be present within side of that register. Well, what if I just simply want a quick way to add a value to a register? Well, that's what the integer add sub multiply blah, blah, blah is for. You basically pass what register you want to write out to and the value of that, and then you just basically add that value to that register. And considering that this is a overflow instruction, you basically set the first instruction as a D class and integer add of the out register, and then whatever the value is to maximize or get the maximum value of that operand. After that, we have a series of other stuff. So we have popping, so E class, I can pop something off the stack. I can increment a register, D class, positive by default. I can decrement registers. I can move value from one register to another. I can do an integer A load, meaning that I have a pointer to an actual object and I want to get the integer value extracted from that object. So I basically have a index register, or the register that's going to represent the index value that we want to access in the array. And then I have the out register, which is going to receive the value from that index point. And this is going to be a C class instruction. I have BRH, which just is a legacy instruction for branching around. You basically have to set, I think it's the ADX register, and it takes the ADX register and jumps to whatever address is inside of there. I don't think I use this anymore. This is a pretty old instruction. Then we have if equal to, if not equal to. Pretty self-explanatory. It's for if statements. So if, I think it checks the CMT register, so if the CMT register is set to true, then we jump to the data that is inside of the ADX register. Now, I want to mention something very important. As you notice, I just said that this instruction uses multiple registers. This is a quote-unquote early hack that I used to basically, when I didn't understand too much of bit shifting, to basically have instructions be a little bit more complicated than they would otherwise be by having all these arguments or these operands here. This instruction requires two things to already be preloaded or preset before this instruction actually executes. So it's really cool. We also have comparison instructions, so less than, greater than, less than or equal to, greater than or equal to. These are all C class, and we have a left and right register. I think this assigns the compute register as well with the result, and we can just read it from there. Another reason, by the way, why you want to standardize having instructions or specific registers to be used for very specific things is you want things to make sense in your compiler. Like the reason why I don't like, because I could have easily converted this if equal to and if not equal to. Like I could convert this to saying, all right, which register do I want to check to see if it's positive, and which register do I want to retrieve the jump to or the go to address from. But the reason why I don't do that is because I want things to be consistent in the programming language. So it's unnecessary to pass those arguments to the virtual machine since I know that it's always going to be the same. So it's actually faster if you just assume those arguments or those things are already set because you don't have to decode those operands, which actually does take time away from executing the instruction itself. After the less than or equal to, we have a series of move instructions. So move local is a way for us to access a local object on the stack. So we get the relative frame address. We can move a stack local, which basically gets an object off the stack based on the relative stack address. This one used a relative frame address. We'll get into a little bit more of how functions are set up a little bit later, but both of these are D class instructions. And as you can see, here's our first example where we use the illegal parameter function. So I basically pass in for move local, the relative frame address, and the fact that it is a D class instruction. And if it is a illegal parameter, meaning I was trying to access the frame address of 1 billion or something, obviously that's too large for this D class instruction because I have a maximum value of 8 million. So with that being said, if that happens, I immediately return an illegal instruction instead, therefore crashing the virtual machine. After that, I have size of to get the size of objects. This is a D class instruction. And I say, what register do I want to write the size out to? I have put and put C, which basically puts values on the console. So put actually puts a number on the console. Put C puts a character onto the console. Check len basically checks the length of an actual data set or an object. So we check the len based on the register that we pass in here. We have jump, which is pretty self-explanatory. It just jumps to a specific address. We have our illegal parameter check, and it is a D class instruction. We have load PC, which is used for getting the actual value of the program counter. Considering that program counter is an actual pointer, as we're executing code, this actually does a calculation to figure out what the actual program counter value is. This can be used for dynamic programming. So if we load the PC into a register, and then if let's say we wanted to jump forward 5 instructions relative to where we are in the program counter, we could basically load this into the ADX register. We can do an integer add on that ADX register. I don't remember where that is. Yeah, so we can do an integer add on that ADX register, adding the current value inside of there with the current integer value of, let's say, 5, pushing it forward 5 instructions. And then we can call the BRH. Where is that at? I don't remember. But we can call the BRH instruction, which relies on that ADX register to be populated to then go forward 5 instructions. So that's kind of a cool way how you can kind of hack things together and make everything work. We have push object, which pushes an object on the stack. We have delete, which deletes an object. We want to call a function. We want to create a new class. We want to move node. So this is kind of similar to what actual processors do at a low level as you're like accessing objects through memory. The way it works is as we have like our object, right? So if we have an object of class and it has, 1, 2, 3 fields in there. Let's say we want to access the second field, which represents another class. If we want to access that, we're going to say move node of 1 because the address is 0 and then 1. So that's the actual address. And then if we want to access a field inside of there, we're going to have to move node again. And let's say that one has 2 fields and we want to access the first one. So we'll say move node of 1 and then move node of 0 to actually get that first field in that object. That's kind of how we do data access in the programming language. And of course, this is a overflow instruction. So you can see the format here. We also want to sleep. This is a legacy instruction. I don't even think I use this anymore. This is basically allowing us to sleep a thread for X amount of, I think, milliseconds. I don't remember. We'll see it later. Test if equal to, test not equal to. This is for comparing whether two addresses or two actual registers are equal to or not equal to. We have lock and unlock. These are for mutex locks on objects. Move G, which actually gets the global singleton address of an actual class. We have move node dynamic, which dynamically accesses a node based on the value that was passed in the register. So we had move node, and this is mainly used for when we know the actual address value of a field. But if we don't know the address value of a field, we can dynamically call move node to then access that field's value. We also have new array or new object array, which just creates a object array. We have not, which pretty self-explanatory. It's for like not if you have like, you know, not and then some value like that in an if statement, and that's what that is. We have skip, which this one is interesting. So the way that my programming language works is I don't have a way to understand the full context of things, meaning that I don't know what the hell's going on as I'm generating code. And I do not have the current brain capacity to figure out how to properly map out the addresses of each instruction. So what I do is I basically skip forward X amount of instructions. And yeah, that's basically it. We'll see what that does later. We also have load value, which loads a value to a register from the stack, I think. Shift left and shift right for bit shifting. These are B class instructions because we have two instructions to shift and one instruction or one register to put the value in. We have skip if not equal to and skip if equal to. These are if checks for whether or not we should skip X amount of data or X amount of addresses. These are C class instructions, and I also have the illegal param checks for both of these. So how long are we? Are we almost done? Yeah, we're almost through it. Bear with me, guys. We're almost done. So we have the and, uand, and or, and xor. These are for unary values. So and, uand, or, and xor. It's pretty self-explanatory. So those values are and, uand, which is unary and. And then we have or. And then we have xor, which is this value. Now, some of you may be thinking, well, what about this, right? Because I have, you know, this and then I have, whoops, this unary and here. Why don't I have this double or? Well, double or is a high-level construct, meaning that if you have this value or that value. I literally don't have a low-level instruction for that because we don't need one. We'll see why later on. After that, we have throw to throw exceptions. We have check null for checking if an object is null. We have return object for returning objects. We have new string for creating strings. We have add values or more math stuff. So this adds a register value to a local frame address value. This is a very quick way to basically add two values from a register and a local field. We have integer add local, which is basically just the same thing, except instead of adding a register value to a local field, we add a integer value to a local field. And these are all overflow instructions, and I have illegal params check here as well. Then we have load local, which I have no idea what it does. It just loads a frame value into a register, I guess. I have no idea. We have pop object for popping a value off the stack into an actual object. We have stack move r, which I don't know what that does. I guess it takes a stack value and puts it into a register. We have a bunch of and local or local xor local. This is a quick way to and or xor a value on a local stack address based on what's in a register. We have register move, which moves a value from a register to a indexed value in an array. So if you want to set, you know, the array value of 0 to 5, well, the 5 value is going to be in the register. We pass that value into that numeric array based on the index register of where we want to set it to. We have stack move, which I don't know. I think this takes... No, I don't know what it does. Okay, so yeah, we have that. We also have return value, which returns an integer to the stack. We have iStore, which I think this sets an integer to the stack. Yeah, so this basically puts an integer value directly on the stack. We have stack move r underscore 2, which takes a frame address and puts that value into a register. And this is pretty much the same instruction. That's why it's stack move r 2, because the first original stack move, it's stack move r, not stack move. I don't remember where it was. But the original stack move r is actually a relative stack address, not a relative frame address. So that's important, and that's why we have a secondary one. We also have stack move r 3, which I don't know what that does either. We also have store local, which, and guys, the reason why I'm showing you these instructions, we have just a few more to go, but the reason why I'm showing you these is because this kind of explains a lot about how my virtual machine is going to work. This is a great way for us to dive in and kind of get a feel and an understanding at a basic level of what's going on. So we have store local, which has, what does that do? We pass an integer value and a relative frame, I don't know. I guess we put an integer value into a frame address value. Didn't we already do that? Whatever. It's late. I'm tired. So we have pop local, which pops the value off the stack into a frame address. We have push null, which pushes a null value onto the stack. We have ipush local, which pushes the integer value from a frame address value, I guess. Yeah. After that, we have push local. Push local, I don't know what it does. We have itest, which does an instance test on two objects on the stack. So we push basically two objects and check to see if they're the same instance. We have invoke delegate, which is actually, this is a huge instruction. This has a crap ton of data. Invoke delegate, we need to pass in the address, the argument count, and whether or not the function is static. So this function is basically used for calling delegate functions. So if we have like an interface function, instead of calling the actual address of the function, that's a hard call. This is a soft call. A soft call basically means we try to call a function, we try to figure out where that function is actually located before we actually execute on that function. So whenever we invoke a delegate, we actually don't know what we're doing until we figure out which function we need to call. After that, we have a positive or negative, which is, I've used this in a couple spots, you've probably seen it around. This is a quick function that basically allows us to pass in an opcode arg, and based on whether or not it's positive or negative, we pass in the appropriate value. That way, I don't have to have this ugly inline if statement here. I just call the function for positive or negative. After that, we have get, which I think actually gets a value from the console, I'm pretty sure, and then we have an out register. We have integer add, which adds a value to a relative stack address. And then we have jump if equal to, jump if not equal to for jumping around. We have ipop local, which pops a integer off the stack to a relative frame address. We have compare, which compares a register value to an integer value. We have call d, which dynamically calls a function. It's a hard call still. It's not like a soft call when we call delegates. But instead of actually passing in the address, we pass in the data that is based on a register's value. Then we have varcast, which, okay, I guess this actually checks to see if the object is in an integer array. So I guess the cast above was actually used for classes, and varcast is used for array casting to check to see if an object is in fact an integer. TLS move local, oh, we're finally finished. TLS move local is used for moving actual thread local storage values. Duplicate is used for duplicating values on the stack. Pop object 2 is used for popping an object directly off the stack into our local object memory. I'll get into what that means later. Swap is used for swapping objects on the physical stack. LDC is for loading constants off the stack or off the actual virtual machine's local memory. And then we have negate or neg. So if we have like, you know, negate a value, so if we have like a number, we can say negative num to basically set that to positive or negative based on whatever the value is. So that's pretty much it, guys. So we've gone through pretty much every single instruction in my programming language. Thanks for sticking around. I know this was kind of a longer video, but I wanted to get this out and kind of get this finished. So, like I said, just make sure you create all the respective opcodes for what you want to do in your programming language. We are going to have to go over these opcodes again when we start going into our multi-threading system, but I wanted to get it out of the way now so that way it'll be a little bit smoother for when I go over them a little bit later. So, hope you guys enjoyed the video. As usual, if you have any questions, as always, put them in the comment section below. And of course, if you guys would love to help support the channel, you can always head over to the GitHub repository at androidfcd/sharp. When you do, definitely watch, start, and fork this repository. That gives this language a lot more visibility and let other developers know this language exists. Also, if you guys are curious about what I do on a daily basis, you can head over to the remastered branch. And in there, I write some pretty decent commits so you can kind of get a gist of what I've been up to without really having to look too much in the code. Now, quick PSA, I'm not going to be committing probably for quite a while because the language is at a pretty decently stable state. I mean, unless something catastrophic happens that I need to fix something, then I'll probably make a commit here and there. But mostly, I'm going to be working on my drone project. So keep that in mind if you don't see any commits. Also, if you're curious about kind of some of the stuff that I'm looking to add to the language that may or may not be new, you can head over to the roadmap section, and in there's tons of stuff, so it's pretty sparse right now. I'm still working through it, but this basically contains all of the various things that I'm looking to add to the actual programming language and to make it better. So, hope you guys enjoyed the video. As usual, if you're new to the channel, definitely consider subscribing, and until next time, see you guys later.